Let's bring the issues to the table on Table Talk with Brenda Perryman. Table Talk is Detroit's only talk show where co-hosts come to the table to discuss issues that affect you. Join Brenda and her co-host Cheryl Ajimu, Dr. Rose Moten, Attorney Tiffany McEvans, Ken Coleman, Chris Summerall, and Robert E. Thomas. Join us every Friday at 1 p.m. on TV 33 WHPR, Comcast 20 in Detroit. Streams live on www.tv33whpr.com. Got an issue? Bring it to the table. The Brenda Perryman Show is sponsored by
Good afternoon, everyone. Today, I want to welcome you to Table Talk with Brenda Perryman right here on TV 33, WHPR, Comcast 20 in Detroit. And we are so happy to be here because this has been a week full of news. We thought about the national news, but we said, nothing seems to be bigger than the local news today, so we're going to bring it to the table. Once again, I'm going to introduce my panelists. This week we have the men. Next week, the ladies will be back stirring the pot. So to my left, I have
Robert E. Thomas,
Chris Summerall,
and Ken Coleman.
And don't they look good, everybody? Yes, they do. I know they do. And we always like to start off with today in Detroit. On this day in Detroit, it's part of a book written by panelist Ken Coleman. Ken, would you tell us what happened on this day?
Well, thank you, Brenda. Certainly on this day, June the 21st, lots of very monumental things happened in our city's history. It was in 1923 when Nicholas Hood II was born. He was born actually in Terre Haute, Indiana, but moved here in Detroit in 1958. And he came to Detroit to become pastor of Plymouth Congregational Church, Nicholas
Hood.
So that was in 1923. In 1967, a little bit closer to 2013, a young man grew up in the city. He was born in Detroit. He grew up in the city. He played high school basketball at Northern High School, Brenda. He played basketball at Northern High School. And he was born in 1967. Can you guess what his name is?
Gosh, I should know this.
Derek Coleman.
I should know this. Today is Derek Coleman's 45th birthday. 46th
really?
Birthday, actually.
Really?
Yeah, happy birthday,
really?
Derek Coleman. Derek obviously went on to play his college basketball at Syracuse University and played in the NBA for several years for, who can name some of those teams? Derek Coleman.
Detroit.
Finished his career in Detroit.
But New Jersey.
He started in New Jersey and in between played for the Philadelphia 76ers. Happy birthday, Derek Coleman. And then, Brenda, in 2004, Detroiters lost a spiritual or revered spiritual leader in our city. The Reverend Charles Butler joined the ancestors on this day in 2004. Reverend Butler was the longtime pastor of New Calvary Baptist Church. You might remember he was a spiritual advisor to Mayor Coleman Young for many years. And he was on the first Detroit Police Commission.
Wow.
Yes, so Reverend Charles Butler.
Yeah. Wow, God rest his soul.
Rest
he did
soul.
A lot of good here in Detroit.
Yeah.
Well, part of our format is that was the week that was. And this week was. But I'm going to start with, we did have one national story that we did want to talk about, and that they did seat a jury on the Zimmerman trial. Zimmerman is being tried for the murder of Trayvon Martin, which took place over a year ago this past February. So they have an all-female jury. they say they have five whites and one Hispanic. And it's so funny because they say one Hispanic or African American, so.
They're not sure.
They're not sure. How do you not be sure?
Well, but,
oh, they can't ask, right?
America is a melting pot. It depends on what the person adheres to, it seems to me.
Huh, that's funny.
Interesting, though, that it's all women.
Yeah, that is interesting. It could go one way or the other on that, but some of the questions that were asked these women, one woman said, yeah, riot started at the march, which a riot didn't start. So her head is already somewhere. So this is going to be an interesting trial. And I do have a short film coming out called In Trayvon's Footsteps, and I think you'll like it. But let's get into local politics and local news. First, the Ayanna Jones case. Last week when we talked, the verdict hadn't come in. But this week when it came in, it was a hung jury, so we have no verdict. So what's happening from there, Robert?
Well, as far as I know of, there is a hung jury, and I believe a second trial will be commencing within the next coming weeks regarding this new trial, since it was a hung jury the first time around.
So what do you think? What do you think happened? Do you think that they were afraid?
No, simply they just couldn't come up with a verdict. They couldn't agree on what the sentence should be. Well, not the sentence, but what the...
The verdict should be whether it was manslaughter or...
Manslaughter or first degree, second degree murder, manslaughter.
I think what was most interesting about it is that the prosecution decided right away that they would try Joseph Weekly, the police officer, again. And so it appears that Prosecutor Worthy believes that she indeed does have a case, and they are going to go at it a second time.
Mm-hmm. It'll also be interesting to see if this the second trial gets the coverage that this initial trial has gotten, and so we'll see if it kind of goes off quietly, and we read those small excerpts about what's going on, or if the interest is still there regarding Ayanna in that trial.
Well, the camerawoman who was filming that night, you know they had that A&E camera crew there, and the camerawoman who was filming that night, she was on the stand. She pleaded no contest because she did videotape the raid but then lied about whether or not she had shown it to anyone, and she had shown it to Jeffrey Feiger.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And so that was obstruction of justice, mm-hmm. So they've given her probation.
A $2,000 fine, I believe.
Yes, and 200 hours of community service. So I don't know what to say about that. Next, let's talk about the big political story of the week, Ken Coleman.
Well, no question about it. I mean, I put on my Facebook page, Brenda, a few days ago, that this has been the most action-packed mayoral election I've seen in this town in 20 years. And it's just June the 21st. very eventful week. When we met last, Mike Duggan was a candidate for Detroit mayor. Now he isn't. Earlier this week, the Court of Appeals refused to put Mike Duggan on the ballot to be a candidate for mayor. There was some question whether or not the Duggan campaign would appeal to the state Supreme Court. Mr. Duggan this week announced that he would not appeal to the Supreme Court on the appellate decision, and so the mayoral field is one less person today, less Mike Duggan.
Right. I thought that would have stirred the pot. I thought it made it an exciting race to have him in it, but I fought his campaign people and maybe him himself. You know, they're lawyers, and lawyers have to learn to read the fine print and everything. And apparently someone didn't read the fine print. And I really fought his campaign. As a candidate, you can't see everything. But I fought them for not looking and being so geeked up that they had to carry all those boxes in there. That was just a lot of smoke, ended up being smoke and mirrors.
Yeah, and there's no one to blame but Mike Duggan himself. I know he has a slew full of attorneys on his roster, but every last one of them should have noticed what was in the charter. They didn't recognize it, and to be on the safe side, they should have waited the extra 2 weeks. They chose not to do it, and now he's off the ballot and left no competition with the other front runner right now. And he was the number one, both he and Benny Napoleon were going back to back, back and forth with front runners. So.
Right, so people are talking about a write-in vote. Write-in vote for Duggan. What do you think about that?
Well, I can tell you, I've covered politics in this town for the better part of the last 20 years, and write-in campaigns, Brenda, would have been very difficult if it was a state rep race or a state senate race. It's virtually impossible, I think, in a citywide race. Cindy Paskey of Strategic Staffing Solutions floated that idea, I understand, yesterday. I've heard Duggan say that a write-in campaign would be too difficult, and that would not be something that he'd be willing to do. But you know, what's interesting, I think, now is this does open up an opportunity for a real discussion about ideas, right?
Right.
Because the elephant in the room, Mike Duggan's whiteness, is not there anymore.
Right.
So Benny Napoleon, Tom Barrow, I got to make sure I get everybody's name or they're going to call
Lisa
me.
House.
Lisa House, Fred Durhall. All the candidates now can talk more about issues and not talk about how long
Crystal
I've lived in
Crittenden.
Detroit. Crystal Crittenden. Didn't want to leave her out. Can talk about real issues and not how long I've lived in Detroit and what my skin color is.
And hopefully this will increase competition. I mean, of course, without Duggan being there, it will no longer, his presence there won't be a part of competition, but hopefully they start challenging each other on issues.
Wouldn't it be nice to see a platform? I mean,
right.
I haven't seen a platform.
All
I've seen is we're not in debt from some candidates are saying we're not in debt. Like you said, the elephant in the room was Duggan, but he's not there anymore. I have not really heard anything. I'm going to get you jobs. How are you going to get us jobs? I hear candidates say that. I do not understand that.
Well, the point I wanted to make was actually with regard to with the Duggan campaign, how simple oversight during a campaign, no doubt, caused a lot of headache and a heartache for Duggan and no doubt his supporters. But if you can imagine being the mayor of the city and having that same, just forgetfulness, whatever it is, where you have thousands and thousands of people who are depending on you to make accurate, informed, and correct decisions timely. And so not to say that anyone else is better or worse, but better you find out someone's propensity to making those errors before they're in office than after. So
because it's like a Cadillac with no air conditioning. You look good on the outside, but you're still a mule and horse harness.
Simply put, you gotta pay attention to the details.
Well, I've actually heard a conspiracy theory. Y'all let me know if you've heard it too. A conspiracy theory that has come not out of the Duggan campaign officially, but by some people that have been close to him, saying this was kind of Duggan's cry for help. That somewhere in this time that he started to think about running for mayor and actually did file petitions for mayor, he decided that he wanted to run for another office, whether it is Wayne County Executive or Governor, and that this, quote, error was not really, was very much intentional in a way of getting him out of the race and moving on to something else. I don't buy it. I think the Duggan people actually were looking for media headlines that day and wanted to be the first campaign to come out and file and get out there strong. And I think that he had a nationally respected elections lawyer on his team.
Yeah.
He had a former state Supreme Court Chief Justice on his team. I don't believe that those guys made that oversight. I believe that there was somebody in the room that was looking at a media angle of this, and they ran out there too early, and obviously it was too early for the Detroit Charter.
Well, I think that it's really, with all due respect, it's not that complicated. I think there's a saying that elephants don't bite, mosquitoes do.
Mm-hmm.
And so sometimes it's the small things that catch us. And so a lot of times we're paying attention to the larger things, the more prominent and the big headlines, when those small things will catch us, not only in our lives, but also in political campaigns. And I think we saw that there.
I think so too. So do you think that Napoleon is a shoe-in? Answer anybody.
He's clearly the front runner.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
There's some people that would there are people that vehemently argue he would have won anyway. I have to say that I did predict Mike Duggan would be back on the ballot and be the next mayor, so I have to take my lashings for that.
At least you admit you made a mistake.
At least I can admit. I wasn't a Duggan supporter, but did predict that he'd win. But I know, I think clearly that this is Benny Napoleon's race to lose. The interesting thing about this race now, if you're just looking at the pure politics of it and not about platform and ideas, who finishes second?
Yeah.
You know, you could make a strong argument for Tom Barrow being a real winner in this week's events, because he has put himself out there as the guy who took the man down, Mike Duggan, and he might have to put him at the number two position, or a serious number two at this point.
Well, I've heard some interviews with him, and he's really not answering a lot of questions himself. You know, because people have been asking some personal things about him, and he won't seem to come off with a straight answer. And I'm always waiting for another shoe to drop. You never know. Mm-hmm. It might be another shoe to drop there also. We also have Crystal Crittenden. We also have Lisa House, who's been running. In fact, I think she was the first person to declare that she wanted to run for mayor. If you want to call us, ask some questions, you could call us at 313-868-0342, 868-0351. Give us a call. So you being, like we said before, on the Charter Commission, mm-hmm. Ken, mm-hmm. Was that the letter of what you all were trying to do?
You know, as I said last week, the charter language right now, the new charter says at the time of filing. For strict constructionists, for judges and lawyers who look at that language, they see no ambiguity, that it says what it says at the time of filing. Now, I happen to think that I would have to go with that if I were a judge or a jurist. I can also tell you, though, being in the room when we deliberated about the issue, I actually used the phrase at the filing deadline in my reasoning for not voting for a one-year residency rule. So in my mind, as an individual, I looked at the trigger date as the filing deadline, but that's not what's in the charter. The charter says at the time of filing.
It sounded like you guys needed an attorney on the Charter Commission.
We had four of them, and including a fifth person who actually wrote it. Here, let me tell you a little bit of something about at the time of filing. That's language that's been in the charter for 100 years. That was a new language. So that language would have been in play in every mayoral election of the last century. So that wasn't the real controversial part, at least in terms of, what makes this, what lawyers look at. What lawyers had to decide was, it really was the one-year residency piece, right? I mean, when was the one-year point at which he became a city resident? Not really at the time of filing, because I agree with folks who make the argument that there's nothing controversial about that.
So, did he buy or lease his house? I'm just wondering.
Will he be there next year?
I believe he said I think he said he wasn't moving and he bought the house when he first came here. I don't think he leased it out.
Oh, okay. I was just wondering. I was just asking.
I know it's fashionable to sort of beat up on Mike Duggan, but I'm not necessarily saying you. I mean, clearly there's some people who are beating up on him right now. They've been doing it all week. But the man bought a house in Palmer Woods. I don't think he's going to move from there. He still owns the house in Livonia. Yeah. He made that very clear during the campaign. And the other point is, let's say he decided to move back to Livonia at one point. There are 250,000 people that have left this town in the last 10 years. Lots of people move back and forth.
Right. Well, I saw an article that said that Tom Barrow, now you have 5%, and now since you made this, you helped knock Duggan off, now you have 6. Do you think that moved him up in the ranks?
I personally think Duggan is a bitter man. I think Duggan takes the position, hey, listen, I've been running for mayor since the Jerry Curl was fashionable. I'm Joe Lewis's nephew.
You're referring to Barrow.
Barrow, excuse me. I lost last time to a guy that used to live in Franklin. I was, it looked like I was going to lose to a guy that lived in Livonia. I mean, I personally think he's very bitter, and this is his, this is his way of expressing his sort of anger and animus about being, a perennial loser at the mayoral level.
I don't see him receiving a bump either. You would think someone of his candidacy probably would get one, but
do you think it's the snitch thing? People don't like a snitch. No, I'm just kidding.
No, I think he rightfully challenged Duggan in the court. He won that, but I don't believe he gets a bump out of that.
I don't either.
His message is not that clear to me.
I don't think he gets a bump, but he does get a little bit more of the spotlight at the time.
That
because, like you mentioned before, Rob, you know, it was really, the conversation was about Napoleon and Duggan. And by him actually accomplishing what he set out to do, now his we're talking about him.
Yeah.
So, and I don't know if we would really be having this conversation if he did not accomplish what he set out to do. So,
well, didn't Duggan and Crittenden, didn't they say that there was no money problem in the city?
I mean, not Duggan, Barrow.
Barrow.
Yeah. Well, I think even Lisa Howes makes the argument that there wasn't a significant enough financial problem in Detroit to trigger an emergency manager. Even Lisa Howes has said that. I mean, my point with all of that stuff about, you know, whether or not the EM, you know, should be here, the EM is here. And guess what? The EM is going to be here for at least 18 months, and I would probably venture to say the EM is probably going to be here longer than that. What I want to hear these candidates say, folks, is I want to hear a platform. I mean, I want to hear, I'm not excited, you know, I've never seen, this was a very exciting campaign up to this point, just from the, you know, the standpoint of watching the politics go back and forth, but I haven't heard anything that would cause this Detroit voter to vote for any of them at this point. Nothing at all. I mean, Detroit's my home, not my hobby. You know, we're not in financial crisis. I mean, all of these sloganeering things that have nothing to do with how you would lead. I'm sorry, that's just my position.
And I agree. I haven't seen or heard of a clear-cut platform, but I have heard of some ideas coming out of a few candidates, and even one
like
just
who?
Left. Well, I mean, I've heard, you know, some ideas come from the Duggan campaign, Napoleon campaign, and even Lisa Howes. I haven't heard of anything anyone else come up with any ideas or a platform.
Email them to me when you get it, because I'm interested
even
in reading.
Even going to the forums, I haven't seen it. You know, you see people Barrow attacking Duggan every chance he got. Now he's not there. I'm not sure who he's going to attack now.
He'll turn on one or the other.
Because
he needs to get media. He needs to stay in the media.
More dishes now, I believe.
He needs to stay out there.
It kind of reminds me of when I was younger, and my mom would leave, and us siblings would be there, and so we kind of fight amongst each other. But the real authority in the situation right now is Kevin Orr, and so I think it's one of those things that where they're really limited as far as what they can do, and they recognize that any conversation that they have at this point in time is contingent on some of the decisions that are implemented by the EM. And so they're going to do what I did with my siblings. They're going to fight, and they're going to scratch each other's face until they're able to do something different. And I think that we've kind of seen that in that it's been more a personal versus actually platform.
Well, personal can't work forever. What about, well, on the city council, Kwame Kenyatta, today is the day he resigned, as of today, right?
Yes. Yeah, I don't see why. He resigned, and I knew he had health issues, and I knew he had, issues with the current emergency manager. But he never told a reason why he was going to resign, or why he's resigning today, for that matter.
I think Councilman Kenyatta has been saying for weeks, even leading up, even before the EM was named, that he has a philosophical, you know, issue with this concept of an emergency manager. The only thing that surprises me about Kwame Kenyatta leaving the city council is that it took so long. I thought that he would have probably left the day after the EM got here officially. You could see it in all of his public comments. I know that he has had a health challenge. That's certainly part of this. But I think the other part of it is his philosophical issue with an EM. And again, I would have thought it would have been closer to March than June when he left.
I was hoping it would be closer to maybe November. Finish out your term. Yeah. I don't see what was the purpose of him.
You haven't been coming to the meetings anyway.
I'm going to kind of just put a different perspective because being an employee of the city, I've seen individuals who have kind of taken that stand, in firefighting. They are chief or captain, and they just one day they come in and said, I've had enough. And so you never know really what a person's whole motivation is at this point in time. You're wondering, we're curious, but at the end of the day, he obviously knew he was limited. Really, what was left to accomplish? All those things kind of come up as far as conversation.
Yeah,
Detroiters elected him, though.
Well, he's taken the position that if the EM makes all the decisions at the end of the day, what use is council? Now, up until this point, I mean, Orr has allowed them to not only continue to get paid, but allow them to do the work that they customarily
do. That's what I was going to ask you. Mm-hmm. What are they doing?
Well, no, weekly they're voting on contracts. They're doing ordinance or city law work. They're doing all the work that they have always done. It's just at the end of the day, on Tuesday, after they finish voting, Kevin Orr has to look at what they voted on and say, I want this, I want that, I want that, I want this. He makes the final decision.
There's going to be some very, 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 very significant changes that are about to really, really start to happen regarding the infrastructure, policy, and practice in the city. And so I'm not sure if it was his position to distance himself from that, because that may be an issue before this gavel comes down. I don't even want my face here when this suffering starts to happen. So that could be a spin on it.
Well, you never know.
We've been suffering for a long time.
Yeah.
Talk about owning some grass.
I don't think there are any more surprises here.
6 foot grass down the street from my house. But go ahead, I didn't want to cut you off, Chris, because I think there's a bigger
Believe
point.
It or not, individuals who are employed by the city still have things that they consider valuable that they can lose.
Yeah.
And while we've lost quite a bit as far as quality of life, and everything, to that effect. Fringe benefits. There's still some things to lose. And so as bleak again, one of these sayings, I once felt bad for a guy with no shoes till I met a guy with no feet. Mm-hmm. And so we have lost quite a bit, but we still do have some things that, may or may not be there in the near future.
Well, here's something that a lot of people aren't talking about with the Kenyatta residency on today. The new charter says something different than previous charters said. The new charter says if there is a vacancy on city council gets to pick that replacement. A two-thirds vote of city council gets to pick a replacement. And that's something new in the charter that we haven't had over the last 100 years. So expect a new controversy about the Detroit City Charter should we replace Kenyatta? Are we too broke to do it? Or democracy should rule, and we should replace Kenyatta with somebody.
Hmm. Well, I don't see why they replace it.
Well, it's an argument to be made.
I mean, really, right now, I just don't see it. And because the population, we still have the size of the city council is the same size it was when there were almost 2 million people.
Yes.
So there are how many people now?
About 700,000.
Okay, my case in point.
Yeah.
Why do we need this full city council? Save the money and don't insert anyone in. I mean, it's not like he was voted for by district.
Right.
And then when they go to appoint somebody, you know the people in Detroit are going to say, well, why'd they point him or why'd they point her? You know, it's going to end up being a big controversy, don't you think?
I'm absolutely certain of it. And I expect maybe the next time we're on this show, we'll probably be talking about it.
Oh, wow. Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Now, there's been a call, Ken, by Tom Barrow for Janice Winfrey to step down.
Yes, given this whole Mike Duggan debacle, Brenda, this whole situation over whether Mike Duggan is fit to be a qualified resident who can run for office in Detroit. Obviously, the city clerk played a role in this situation. She, through her office, is the institution that gives candidates the legal fitness to run. This week, Tom Barrow, mayoral candidate, said, in part because Janice Winfrey has really messed up this process on Duggan and previous elections too, it's time for her to step down. And so the mayoral candidate says that the sitting clerk, who's going to count his votes in a few weeks, should step down. So it's another interesting political drama in our city.
So what do you all think about that? What do you think about that? Do you think she should step down?
No, I really think she should stay. I don't see any reason to step down. I think the voters will have their say come November, who they're going to put in office. August.
Not clear whether or not she'll have serious competition, but she certainly will be on the ballot.
I think that's clear. She doesn't have serious competition. I've seen those guys at the forums, and I don't see anyone else even coming.
Well,
in
I think
picking.
Today, Dieta
Wilcoxon.
She's
probably her stiffest competition if she's on the ballot. I know there was a legal issue whether or not she would be or not.
Just thinking about what type of situation do you put the city in if she does step down? So, I mean, do you incur, does the city incur?
She's not going to step down.
She says she's not.
I think it's Tom Barrow. You know, I kind of got on Tom Barrow today to be sure. But, I mean, he has been masterful. He's been masterful in staying in the media. Mm-hmm. I mean, he clearly has a gift for getting on the front page of newspapers. And I think this is just another one in a long series of about 30 years of doing so.
But don't you think that it looks like I'm trying to be relevant? Don't you think it looks like he's fighting for his relevancy?
I think Tom Barrow is a bitter man. I think he is a man that lost to Coleman Young twice, soundly. He has lived in the city all his life. He is Joe Louis's nephew. He's been running since the Jerry Curl was fashionable. And I think he believes that this is his town. He believes that this is his time. And when you see people move from Livonia, when you see people move from Franklin, that's insulting to him. And I think that he feels personally offended to the extent that he believes that he should run for mayor. The problem is people have said that they don't want him to be mayor, several times now. And so that's where we are.
So you're saying he rode the bench long enough, and now he's a senior, and they wanted to start a freshman over him.
I think that's not a bad analogy.
That's a great analogy.
But his skills aren't there.
Problem is he can't hit a jump.
He doesn't have a game. So,
what are the skills? I mean, Crystal Crittenden was the law attorney for the city.
Mm-hmm. Corporation counsel, lead attorney, chief attorney for the city.
Okay, but what I noticed is she did not, a compromise was not part of her thing. And I think that being a candidate, you have to learn to compromise. And I understood that she felt she wrote it to the letter of the law, her position, but I would like to see, like to know, you're more than just a mayor. There's a mayor, there's a city council, of course there's an emergency manager, but compromise is important politically.
What I just haven't seen, some of these candidates for mayor, I know them. I've covered them as a reporter. I've worked on campaigns, with them. I know a little of them. I know the least about Crystal Crittenden. But my concern as a Detroit voter is I've got to know a whole lot more about you than you fought the law on the emergency manager piece. While that was laudable, I want to know where you stand on the issues. And let me just say this, too. I mean, it's early. It's June the 21st. Absentee ballots will begin to go out. You'll start hearing more platforms and planks from candidates. You'll hear a lot more as we get into July and August. And so I don't want to be too critical on these candidates. I do believe that it is early in the campaign season, but it's striking to me, somebody who's as engaged on day-to-day politics as I am, I just haven't heard a lot from these people other than the platitudes. Great, beautiful prose. I mean, some of their, some of their teams have written some great things, and they've come up with some great one-liners. I want to see them come up with some platforms.
Absolutely.
And not the shoes.
Well, the people of Detroit deserve it. They deserve more than just rhetoric and all of that. They deserve it. Now, we have a new edifice getting ready to come to town. Robert, you want to tell us about it?
Well, sure. I believe it's all on the news right now about the fact that the Red Wings have a new home within the next 2 to 3 years. I believe 2016, they're building a $650 million complex in the cusp of Midtown to downtown.
Where exactly is it?
It's It's that Cass Corridor area.
Midtown.
They call it Midtown.
Well, they call it the entertainment district too. So it's going to be, they're putting up shops, retail shops. I believe they once talked about a mall, but that's not coming. They have the retail shops coming. They're supposed to be adding on or hiring up to 8,000 people. I've seen numbers between 5,000 to 8,000 people. I'm not sure where exactly going to come from. Hopefully they're Detroiters proper, but I'm not sure if that plan has been devised yet.
Well, I'm sure it is now. I think they said Woodward and I-75.
Yeah. West of Woodward and just north of I-75.
Or where they have those lots?
Yeah, so parking lots.
Yeah. Up to Temple, basically. Yeah. Up to pretty much in the territory of Masonic Temple, the Michigan Chronicle, Cass Tech. Mm-hmm. That'll probably be the north border of the complex.
It's also building a hotel to go along with it also.
Mm-hmm. Oh, really?
Yes.
Who's going to pay for this? I think you have some information, Chris.
That was one of the really big points of conversation. Who's going to fund it? And so we've got some information I'm looking at right in front of me that actually there are going to be some bonds, some 30-year bonds that will be issued from the Michigan Strategic Fund that will cover the lion's share, about $450 million. And then there will be a different pieced in. There will be a $12.8 million year property tax by the state and the...
Wait, property tax?
Yeah.
Are you saying I have to help pay for this?
We.
No.
Self-sacrifice.
But has that been approved?
Well, I believe at this point everything is tentative and still kind of getting any type of structure to it. But I think the
number. So wait a minute. Somebody thinks of an idea. Yes. Oh, I want to build this arena, this entertainment district, and Brenda Perryman's going to have to pay out of her pocket. I have to pay for it. I may never go.
That argument can be said about a lot of things. I don't have any children, but my taxes go toward education. So, that argument has validity.
This is different. You have to have education.
Well, I mean, it's different because the money is coming out of your pocket versus mine. But I think that I'm excited when I hear news about it like this. You know, I think that with everything that's going on in the city of Detroit, when you hear about investment, mixed investment, private and public, it's still exciting because there's still interest here. I think that we all recognize that there is a certain synergy, even if it is just downtown, midtown area specifically right now, but it's a base point. And I think that, given the right moves, we can start to extend it northwest and east from there. So.
And that's going to happen. I mean, you think about the townhouses, just like $50,000 right across the street from the proposed site. With this news alone, I'm pretty sure its property value is skyrocketing.
I'm looking at a couple of
it will be skyrocketing. as of today, is skyrocketing. Yeah, so.
I think the interesting thing, the way to look at this, I think, Brenda, is a couple things. One, public-private partnerships are really the way that stadia are built in America. Certainly that's the example that we saw with Comerica Park. Certainly that's the example that we saw with Ford Field. And if you don't like public-private partnerships, at least in this sense, it's a little bit better because at least in terms of the boilerplate agreement is that the private money outweighs the public money in this instance. That's generally the way it happens now. You have sports owners who will tell you in a minute, in some cities, I'm moving out of town unless government builds the stadium entirely. At least here, you have a situation where you do have a mix. And in the case of Ford Field, let's go back about 12 years. I mean, some of the public money comes from like taxes from rent-a-cars and hotel rooms. And so not necessarily sin taxes, if you will, but not necessarily day-to-day property taxes that people pay. I think it's a good thing, particularly if the ancillary businesses that they've talked about becomes a real entertainment complex. If they happen, I think it's a good thing. Other than that, I mean, it really is a shift. It's Joe Louis Arena moving up 1 mile.
Yeah. Oh, Joe Louis. I forgot about Joe Louis Arena. Mm-hmm. What's going to happen to Joe Louis Arena?
Well, the city owns it. If you remember 35 years ago, Coleman Young, and I think what ended up being a brilliant move, Coleman Young got federal money to build Joe Louis Arena, and he built it even before he knew the Red Wings would be there. In fact, when the day that it opened, they had just really struck a deal with the Norris family, the owner of the Red Wings. It'll probably sit there for some period of time. Maybe, hopefully, it can be incorporated in an even more expanded Cobo Hall, it's going to cost a lot to demolish it, and since we own it, we'd have to pay for it.
Oh, so it's like Field of Dreams, build it and they will come.
It's been the argument for the last 30 years.
Unless the Pistons come along and...
A lot of people would love to see the Pistons come back.
Oh, man.
Well, they certainly wouldn't go play in Joe Louis Arena. They would certainly play in the new arena.
Yeah.
That's what you see, baseball. That's what you see basketball and hockey teams do in other parts of the country and other cities. I think Joe Louis Arena is probably going to sit there for a little while, just like the old Wayne County building has sat there for a little while and some other buildings downtown.
Okay, let me do this scenario then. You say, what if they did, and they probably play at this entertainment complex, but you know that sometimes, what if the Pistons made it to the semifinal or finals, and you know how they have the Pistons playing and the Red Wings. Mm-hmm. You know how they can be playing at the same time. Mm-hmm. What would happen?
Other cities have worked it out. You'll see agreements from other. What you have seen over the years is agreements from other sports stadiums to host a game. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of people remember the last time the Detroit Pistons played a game in Detroit. It was at Joe Louis Arena when they couldn't get the Silver Dome. They played a basketball playoff game there in the 80s. I think that this development is a good thing for the city. Yeah. For the most part, I am sort of skeptical about some of the ancillary entertainment things, but if it happens, that's great. If nothing else, you get a more state-of-the-art stadium for the sports buying fan, because I can tell you, as somebody who goes to Joe Louis Arena, try to go to, and Brenda, you don't have this problem like me and Robert and Chris do, but try to go to a restroom at Joe Louis Arena at intermission of a hockey game or intermission of a concert. It's horrible. It's a horribly built stadium, at least in terms of 21st century architecture. And I don't know that anybody...
It only has 800 steps to walk up.
Right.
We have William on the phone. We have a phone call. Good afternoon, William.
Hi, good afternoon to you and your guests. I wanted to chime in, though, in the fact that Mike Gillich is already under fire for allegedly not paying back taxes to the city over 20 years since... developed his Foxtown properties, that he's gotten abatement and has been skirting taxes owed to the city of Detroit and the citizens because of his initial investment downtown in that area when it was not fashionable for others who have money in this state to invest in downtown. And that being said, the fact the media came out yesterday or wherever, and they made the big rollout of this so-called plan, that what the parameters would be, there's never been any public comment. There's never been any public feedback about are they happy with. Who's the great genius that came up saying that it would be a 56-44 split between the Illiches and the public? From what I remember, I was never asked by referendum or by public hearing even to see if I wanted to participate in giving 44 cents of my dollar to this project. And, you know, I don't want to say it angers me, but it pees me off that when I hear this and people get behind this, like this is some big grand panacea. You know, there's never been any debate within this community. And when I see how the Illiches have profited off of this city, I'm all for business, but I'm for reciprocal business. I'm for fair business. I'm for you get something out of it in some type of community benefits agreement. The Illiches own Motor City Casino. They own Foxtown. They are making tons of money. They have enough money to finance this project 100%. It's psycho, and I see people from my own community jumping on board saying, oh, this is great. This is wonderful. It's going to create jobs. It's going to be this and that. You know, I wish our community would start being a little bit more
proactive,
critical thinking caps on.
Right. I'll
stand by and listen.
I agree with you. Can we have some of the panelists talk on that?
Well, I believe Kevin Orr mentioned something about that he was going to go after Illich if he owes any money at all to resolve the issue of the back taxes he's been avoiding paying the city.
But William was saying, where's the outrage from the citizens?
Well, I
that's
think
not exactly what I'm saying, Ms. Perriman.
Oh, I'm sorry.
My point is that I hear all the public commentators, the selected media people who are, you know, from our community and other communities in general, the ones that 247 in the Free Press and the news like to quote and say, well, yeah, you know the community's behind this, and that's not true. That's not true. We see the same thing when we see these polls that come out about people who are leading in the mayoral election. And I don't put any stock in anything much of 247, the news and the Free Press. Let's just look at that for a minute. The news and the Free Press are owned by the same corporation. One purports to have a conservative slant to their journalistic view, the other one a so-called liberal slant. But Nolan Finley and Stephen Henderson are one and the same in their commentaries to me. Particularly when it comes to the agenda of the 83-85% black community in Detroit, the same with 247. You know, I watched all the, during this Carney trial and the coming pending bankruptcy and the selection of Orr as our emergency manager. You know, every time they would lead in with a story with about the emergency manager, there was always the story about the ongoing Kwame saga first. That's psychological propaganda. I watched them. Then I watched how Kevin Geeks at four had been arrested back in April for drunk driving and was in jail for literally a month, the same Channel 4 that has phone apps for Kwame and his shenanigans. The same thing with LaDuff, an alcoholic over at Channel 2. But you never hear those stories in the media.
They seem to come in and go out. They come in and go out all on the same day. All on the same day. Could we have some comment from the audience? Because we do have another call, and I appreciate it, William. They're going to comment on this. Thank you.
I think William raises a point that I've already begun to hear on talk radio in the couple of days since this announcement has been made. It is an issue, particularly for a lot of residents who live in the inner city and say, well, you know, I can't get some of the basic things in my neighborhood, but we can continually have these projects downtown. Really what happens in Detroit happens, in this particular instance, happens all over the country. Sports owners really have government over the barrel. They can decide to move to an outlying area in the region. They can decide to move their franchise with the help of their ownership to another part of the country. It is one of those things that classic argument about building new stadiums now with these public-private partnerships. Now, the interesting thing about 25 years ago when Bill Davison built the Palace of Auburn Hills, he used all his own money. He bought the land, he built the place, and that's one of the reasons why you're probably not going to see the Pistons come back down here is because they own everything up there. They made that investment. I think that he does have a point. I think at the end of the day, though, I'd rather side with having the project than not having the project, not having it. But a community benefits agreement, I think, is a discussion that we should have been having.
I agree with that. Now we have. I really appreciate William's insight because you could tell he's learned it.
Yeah.
He's learned it. We have Brother Knight on the line. Good afternoon, Brother Knight.
Good afternoon.
No
one has paid property tax or corporate tax since Coleman Young passed on none of the buildings downtown. It's unfortunately that these people owe millions and millions of dollars in back taxes.
Brother Knight, how do you know that?
Because I have a very, you know, powerful family. So, you know, Coleman, and after he passed, no one has paid corporate tax or property tax. And then you have the nine families that own the state. Basically, you know, the city and the state is not broke. It's power tricks. And, you know, around there in Midtown, between all the families, they want all the employees to move from Woodward and Seward all the way downtown between Wayne State, DMC, Ford Hospital, just about them bought up all the land almost down to Hicksville, USA. So between Dan Gilbert, Roger Penske, Peter Comano, the Illiches, and the Ford family want all the employees to move down here in Midtown. And HUD is giving them so much money to build these condos and these townhouses that's not for us, unfortunately. So we're going to basically have two Detroits I don't know if you remember that movie RoboCop, the first one and the second one that came out. We're going to have two Detroits, unfortunately, if we don't wake up and smell the coffee.
Okay.
I think we've had two Detroits for 400 years.
Right.
Can I just do this real quick? I know I had a tendency to run my mouth. But also in your criticism, Knight, to extend your argument, you would also have to criticize the last 40 years of mayoral leadership and the last 40 years of city council leadership, because guess what happens at city council tables and in mayor's offices for the last 40 years? Businesses get abatements, abatements to come down here. That's the people that you voted for. So the same people that you vote for every 4 years, and I'm talking about it in the abstract, Knight. I don't know who you vote for particularly, but collectively people get abatements to come downtown all the time. And guess what? It's going to continue. When Mike Ilitch made the decision to refurbish the Fox, he basically got it for a dollar. When Peter Camanos built CompuWare, he basically got it for a dollar. That was Dennis Archer and the city council's decision to do that. It's not like they came in here and stuck somebody up.
And that's really what major corporations, not small business and things like that, really the ones that get the abatements are the big corporations.
We got to move on. We have about 9 minutes, and we have a lot to say in these 9 minutes, but we have our old friend Clyde on the line. Good afternoon, Clyde.
Hey. Hey, you and I have had a good time today, haven't we, Mr.
Yes, we have.
Did you enjoy my singing earlier?
We really did. We talked about it off camera, too. It was very good, in fact.
It was my honor for you beautiful ladies, and I love your show and your distinguished gentleman you have there. And the gentleman who I had the dialogue with, and we go, peace and blessings to you, brother. But what I want our community to come away with is that when we have these kind of dialogues, we can agree to be disagreeable, and we don't have to attack and want to kill and beat up each other,
Absolutely.
And I must, before I put in my 2 cents, you know I got 3 cents I want to put in.
Well, you got to just put in 2 because we don't have a lot of time.
I was downtown taking care of some of my personal business. And I must say, I do agree with the gentleman. We really got to get our city up into the 21st century. I was down there trying to get some copies of some documents, and I mean, it was just like going back in time where they couldn't even make copies for me, and there's brown paper around on the wall talking about power for tomorrow and all that back in Coleman's days. You know, we really got to upgrade our software system that runs this city, because it's just like real antiquated. Now, I will disagree with you again, though, brother.
Yes.
I'm in favor of the Ilitches doing their project. They've become successful enough over the years that they've been doing business with this city. They got enough money in their bank account to pay that other 44 cents, like the other folks were calling in. They have that. That's not fair.
We don't disagree on that. Where do we disagree?
Pardon?
Where do we disagree? We don't disagree on that.
Oh, you agree with me. Okay. Well, those who would say that they don't mind taking 44 cents of their dollar to help a billionaire build his new city within the city, his own profit, because he will be owning this and getting the profits from it, the revenue. And that goes to back something you said earlier about the people that we're electing. That's why, you know, to me, when I look back on the Archer administration and some of these other people that have lauded them when they were supposed to be so different from Coleman Young and the others, these community benefits agreements, the people who we have sitting at the table negotiating on our behalf from the mayor and city council, in hindsight, looking back, I can say not even the last 40 years, but I know since the Arch administration, and that includes mayor and council, they're not very good. That's why I'm glad, and it's my hope now that people will start paying attention. We've got people down there that talk good enough, they connect with the right ministers to get just enough votes to get elected.
That's not true
representation. You know what I'm saying, Ms. Perryman and the other gentleman guests? Now we have to take our demands, if you will, of the people that we elect to another level and ask them, okay, you want to sit down with these sharks like Kevin or these corporations that want to do business with Detroit? What kind of negotiating skills do you have? And not just with our mayor and city council. I look at our state legislature up in Lansing, the people who we elect to Wayne County Commission, the judges.
I think you're talking about across the board.
We voted for them. So I want to just close it out by saying that I'm glad shows like this and this TV station are there for us to have this dialogue. But it's my hope as you and your guests are out in the community engaging people, you all have to educate our people. We remember, we live in a city, although we're 85%, half of us are, like, technically functionally illiterate. Yeah. So the more information we share and talk about these things with each other, I think it'll help. Now, my personal choice of mayor is going to be Tom Barrow and definitely Deetta Wilcoxon for city clerk. I'm not a Janice Winfrey person at all.
Okay.
So I'll listen off there and listen to your comments.
Thank you
for letting me get my 3 cents in. You all have a great summer and great weekend. Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. All right.
Thank you. We just have enough time to talk about the peace walk and last night. I wanted to get to the pension, but we have 5 minutes. We're going to get to that next week, so save that information. Chris, looking sad.
No,
but we just have the 5 minutes. We ended up talking so long. The Peace Walk is tomorrow.
Tomorrow at 9 o'clock. All everyone is being encouraged to meet at Woodward and Forest. And to remember the 50th anniversary of the Walk to Freedom.
Please come out.
Definitely a worthwhile effort. I 50 years ago, Congressman Charles Diggs said every Negro should be walking.
Yeah.
I think if he were living today, he would certainly say the same thing.
Absolutely. Gosh, time flew. It really flew. But tell you how insulated I was. In 1963, I was years old, and I didn't know about it. I didn't know about the Peace Walk. But there were other contemporaries at the other schools, because I went to a little Catholic school, they knew about it, and they got down there. But I don't know, news just, it was different then. But everyone, we encourage you to come out. Come on, let's see how many people we could have down there. I know there are a lot of groups going. They'll have their banners. There's going to be a lot of people going. And then it culminates down at Hart Plaza.
Rally at Hart Plaza.
Rally at Hart Plaza. Okay, last night was the end of basketball, as we know it, this season. I, of course, have a little poem leading into it. It's short, so stick with me. It's called Basketball. I love basketball. Watching limber, lean bodies parade swiftly up and down the court does something to me. With gazelle grace, those long legs take one step to my fore as they weave in and out and around other four-legged wonders. Ooh, I love basketball. I love the shot clock dictating the speed of the men as they dribble, pass, pick and roll, shoot, and rebound the rock. Then with passion, it's stolen, lost, and shot again. Swish, oh, dunk, ah. I love basketball. That's it.
Well, I think that was amazing. Yeah, I think it's appropriate that we.
I love basketball.
That was very passionate.
My mother played basketball in the early 30s.
All right.
Yeah.
All right.
My brother played in the 60s.
Oh, wow.
I was on the team.
Okay.
I kind of played when the girls could walk 3 feet, step three and pass. And then my kids play, and my son's in the Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
I love it.
Okay.
So
I love basketball. I think that our perspectives are a little different when we see the game. So I don't know if I would have rolled
you
it
don't
up
like
the same,
to see those long-legged
the same poem. But speaking of last night's finale, where the Miami Heat won their second consecutive NBA Finals.
Two
peas. And, I think that...
I wish it was the Pistons.
King James wanted it.
King James. I think he's earned that name. And, I know there's probably a lot of folks watching that aren't quite fond of him. But I put on one of my posts on Facebook last night that, you know what, he earned it.
Yeah.
And we're really in the process of watching greatness. And so, to the haters, just fall back and enjoy.
What is that you wrote?
I just wrote three letters to describe LeBron, MVP, MVP.
It.
So, it's all in fun, but, I was enjoyed. I was entertained by the finals. I think it was an instant classic.
Yeah.
I think that I haven't seen a finals of that intensity since
right.
the bad boy day.
All right, Chris. All right, Chris. Robert, can you pass me that haterade
okay,
over there?
30 seconds. Oh, yeah, the haterade. The haterade. But it was a good final.
Great
series.
Great series.
Great series. I akin it to college basketball, because college basketball, they play their hearts out. And that's more exciting. At least this got exciting as far as the NBA is concerned. And I always wonder, how did the whole crowd wear white? How does that happen? Yeah. But it's a unity thing, and hopefully next year the Pistons will be in the finals.
There we go.
It's always next year.
Yeah.
Always next year.
Maurice Cheeks.
And there's always next week.
I'd
like to thank you for joining us right here on Table Talk with Brenda Perryman. I think that my co-host stirred the pot. And next week we're going to have the ladies stirring the proverbial plot. Sometimes we're going to mix it up and have a couple men, a couple ladies too. So I want you to stick with us, and it's going more to come. And you know this political season is coming, and we got a lot. We're going to have special guests on. And everything, and right on this show, I may step to the side, let my co-hosts interview some of those people, put them on the hot seat, but nobody's better than putting them on the hot seat than me. I mean, I could do it. But anyway, thank you, everybody, for joining us. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
I like those long-legged wonders. Ooh, oh, Gazelle Grace. Oh, goodness.
You got it.
Pass.
We will see you next week, right here on TV 33 WHPR.
Let's bring the issues to the table on Table Talk with Brenda Perryman. Table Talk is Detroit's only talk show where co-hosts come to the table to discuss issues that affect you. Join Brenda and her co-host Cheryl Ajimu, Dr. Rose Moten, Attorney Tiffany McEvans, Ken Coleman, Chris Summerall, and Robert E. Thomas. Join us every Friday at 1 p.m. on TV 33 WHPR. Comcast 20 in Detroit. Streams live on www.tv33whpr.com. Got an issue? Bring it to the table. The Brenda Perryman Show is sponsored by Good Samaritan Comfort Transportation.
Good Samaritan Comfort Transportation is one of Metro Detroit's leading charter bus companies. With safe, deluxe transportation throughout the U.S. and Canada, Good Samaritan offers low prices and superior service. On board our fleet of clean motor coaches, you'll find comfortable seating, DVDs, Wi-Fi, and a safe, smooth ride. So for all your group travel needs, let Good Samaritan Comfort Transportation take you there. Check out our website at gscomforttransportation.com or call us now at 248-742-9324 for a free quote. Leave the driving to us.